In the health care summit this week, there was one Republican President Obama didn't want to mess with, someone who knows as much about the issue as he does. We want to go inside the numbers of health care reform with Wisconsin Congressman Paul Ryan, the GOP's top man on the House Budget Committee. Congressman, one of the big disagreements, in fact, perhaps the first big disagreement at the summit, was the question of whether or not the Democratic plan would raise or lower people's right. health care premiums. Isn't it true, in fact, that most Americans would end up paying less?
No, it's not untrue. The Congressional Budget Office says they will get higher premium increases, 10 to 13%. Private actuaries put those premium increases in a double-digit to triple-digit territory. The Blue Cross plans are telling us you're going to see a massive spike in premiums for people. That's the problem. What we're hearing coming out of Washington, the rhetoric, doesn't match the actual facts that are underneath this legislation. But let's get this point clear. We're not going to have more insurance competition under this new law. We're going to have less insurance competition. That's going to increase prices. And if you put more mandates on insurance, as this does, this federalizes the regulation of health insurance, displacing states' rights. That's going to make it more expensive. So what this bill attempts to do is, yes, make health insurance much more expensive, and then just have Washington subsidize more of it to try and limit people's out-of-pocket costs. That's a deficit nightmare. It's a cost nightmare. And so you will be putting more costs onto the backs of the taxpayers at the end of the day here. The CBO has to score the legislation that's put in front of them. And the legislation that's been put in front of them is full of smoke, mirrors, and gimmicks. Let me give you an example. It double counts Medicare cost savings. It double counts increased taxes for Social Security, increased premiums for this new class act. If you take all the double counting out of the bill, which the CBO can't do because that's the way it's put in front of them, this thing has a $460 billion deficit in the first 10 years, a $1.4 trillion deficit in the second 10 years. Two things. This bill looks like it reduced the deficit because they raised taxes a half a trillion dollars over 10 years and cut Medicare a half a trillion dollars over 10 years to pay for 6 years of spending. So 10 years of tax increases and Medicare cuts with 6 years of spending makes it look as if this thing reduces the deficit. And then if you double count those tax increases, those Medicare cuts, which this does do.
Well, explain the double counting, though. What do you mean double counting?
Right. So they're bringing in more money for premiums to pay for a new entitlement called the Class Act. You can't count that premium increase for deficit reduction. They're taking more money in Social Security taxes, which is reserved for Social Security benefits. And if you're not going to pay those benefits, then you can use it. But you can't count it both for paying benefits and reducing the deficit. If you're going to say that all these Medicare cuts are improving the solvency of Medicare, which is what they say, then you can't use that money to spend on the creation of another government program. So what they're doing is they're raiding a half a trillion dollars from Medicare to pay for a new government program, and you can't say that's going to improve Medicare, which is what they're saying. So in each of these cases, they're counting the numbers twice.
Okay, but let me ask.
Now, there are a couple. I can go great into the detail here, but one of the things they're saying is... Okay. One of the things they're saying is we're putting this new commission in charge of Medicare that is not elected, unelected bureaucrats, to ration care and put the clamps down on spending. And they're saying if this commission does its job, cuts Medicare even more across the board, then that will happen. Other point is the president's own chief actuary of Medicare and Medicaid is saying quite the opposite. He's saying this is going to increase health care costs by $222 billion over the first 10 years. And so instead of bending the proverbial cost curve down, it's going up. So when you actually look at a real-life look at how these numbers add up, and you take out the smoke and mirrors that the CBO can't take out in their analysis, it reveals these things as not being true. Right. What CBO measures is, you know, the cost of government, and they say we'll have $54 billion of savings with medical liability reform. What they cannot measure, and I understand why they can't measure this, they can't measure all of that defensive medicine. They can't measure all the additional tests that are being ordered by doctors, not because it's good health care, because it's good liability protection. They don't measure all of that. So there's a lot of stuff that is not being measured that we would appreciate from if you actually did medical liability reform. So what John Boehner is saying is if we actually get rid of the process of defensive medicine by having real tort reform, that would give us a lot more cost savings. Those are cost savings that the CBO just can't measure. Well, there's lots of Republican bills. That's one particular bill the president was talking about. The president referenced the bill that I have with Tom Coburn, Devin Nunes, and Richard Burr, which covers those 30 million people, which gets us toward full coverage in America without all these new tax increases, without all these Medicare cuts. So we believe we can get to the same coverage numbers without having a government takeover of health care. We propose to do it through refundable tax credits, to give people the ability to have tax credits by ending the discrimination against people who don't buy health insurance from their jobs. And we say there are better ways of doing this. So there are lots of Republicans' ideas that have been offered all session long to get at this coverage number without massive tax increases, Medicare cuts, and a government takeover of health care. The point is, we've been frozen out of this process, Chris. The only time we've had bipartisan discussion, you've seen it because it's been on TV. We've been frozen out of this process all session long, and it's quite clear to us that they're really not interested in engaging and collaborating on bipartisanship. They want to jam this thing through. That is not the only way to do it, and the Republican alternative says there's a better way to do it, which is well-funded high-risk pools in the states that make sure we target substitutes to those people who have pre-existing conditions. You accomplish two things by doing that. You make sure that that person who has a chronic disease gets the care they have and they need so that they don't go bankrupt when they get sick. And by subsidizing their coverage, you actually lower the price of health insurance for everybody else. Unlike the Democratic plan, it raises everybody's health care costs. So what we're saying is you don't have to unnecessarily raise everybody's premiums to help those with pre-existing condition. Let's target and focus our support to those with pre-existing conditions to help them get affordable coverage. And by doing it the way we're proposing to do it, you actually lower everybody else's premiums. We think that's a better idea, and you can do it without making everybody buy health insurance. Look, this is let me give you this. They're saying you have to buy what the federal government defines. We've never done that before. They do not now have the votes from our best count. I wouldn't count her out because she is very good at muscling votes. They were down 24 on cap and trade the night before. They passed it by 8. So the speaker is very good at making deals behind closed doors and muscling votes. But right now, they don't have the votes.